Hi, it's Paige Hamilton from Helmet. You're listening to the Midwest Mixtape Podcast. All right.
Welcome to the Midwest Mixtape Podcast, live from the Barn Studio in Southeast Missouri. You got the Mox here, and I'm joined with a special guest online right now. We have Mr. Paige Hamilton of Helmet. Paige, how are you, man?
Hello, sir. I'm well. How are you?
Doing really good. I want to say congratulations on the upcoming album and tour. You know, after years of not having any Helmet, we're back in the saddle again. We're out touring. We have a new album coming out. What's that feel like for you?
It's been great. Yeah, it's really really fun. I mean, we did all these anniversary tours, you know, the 20th Meantime, 20th Betty, 30th Band. And it, you know, everybody's like, what took you so long to write an album? And just, you know, we got up to other things. So it's been really, really fun and love playing. We're doing 5 new songs live right now. Then by the time we get to St. Louis, hopefully we'll have a 6th.
And you guys are out on tour right now.
Yeah. We're soaking up in Pawtucket, Rhode Island today. It's very, very wet.
You have a show tonight then?
Yeah, they're setting up right now. So just doing my morning, well, it's afternoon, but morning ritual, playing a little guitar, and we have leaks in our rig. So I had to move my guitar stuff, but it's pretty funny. At least, I guess there's some flooding going on in New York City. I was reading about it, so.
We're going to be catching you in St. Louis, October 11th, Wednesday, October 11th at Del Mar Hall with the Look Left Tour, Helmet with Soul Blind. Doors are at 7, shows at 8, all ages, of course. General admission, $27. We are looking forward to having you back in town.
We love it. Love Del Mar, too. I invited the School of Rock, my School of Rock kids down. You know, I had to, I don't know if you guys know, but I did, during the pandemic, I did a couple of songwriting classes with Kirkwood and what's the other one, starts with a B, the other there's two schools of rock in St. Louis. I worked with both of them, really good people, good kids, and so I invited them down. Chan, who's the current musical director there, is going to bring, I don't know how many kids, 15 16 17 kids down for sound check and the show and stuff, so we're really looking forward to that. It's been cool. St. Louis is the birthplace of my grandmother, so it's one of my soul cities.
Oh, very cool. And when we say all ages on the show, we really mean it. We got the kids from School of Rock coming down. That's really neat. I wasn't aware of that.
Yeah, I love that. I love all ages shows. We've been seeing so many kids at these shows, you know, up in like Grand Rapids, Michigan, or I'm trying to think where else. Well, we're Pawtucket today, but I can't think of where else we played. And it's just great. You see these little kids down front, like 10, 12, 13 years old, you know, and some of them, it's their first concert. One guy had his son there in Milwaukee, and he said it's his 33rd concert. I'm like, and he's 10? Like, what? That's crazy. I didn't see my first concert till I was 16 years old. So that's funny. It's pretty cool, man.
Yeah, same. I was probably 16. And then, you know, I have 3 daughters, younger daughters, and they've been to several concerts. So it's like, I wish I would have been exposed to these kinds of things at an early age.
Yeah, it's such a great experience. We took a Volkswagen van from Medford, Oregon to Eugene, Oregon, where Jethro Tull was playing at MacArthur Court, which is the University of Oregon's former basketball court. And it was just this rickety old, beautiful building where my uncle actually played basketball in the 40s for the Ducks. And God, it was just such a great experience. I was like, this is what I want to do. I want to do that. I want to be on stage. I want to play music. And it's such a great thing for kids. One of my dear friends, his son is my godson. His daughter is really into Tame Impala, I think it is. It's
Like an indie band.
Band from Australia who they appear to have borrowed our artwork from Dead to the World, but I was like, whatever. The same we had the Red Sand, the blue sky, white clouds, Red Sand for that album cover, and they I saw their album cover and I was like, hey, yeah, there's that Red Sand again. But it's just so cute to see them. Like, I love, kids that are able to connect with music. That I feel like it's just such a positive force, and that's kind of the point of this album. I've been joking about, Bob Marley, One Love, or the Beatles, All You Need Is Love. And this is my version of that. Can't we just all get along? Mine's a little presented in a little more sort of, venomous way, but it's the same idea, we're all right. Just citizens of the earth. Let's just, let's treat each other with respect and kindness. And, after everything we've been through over the last 7-8 years, whatever. So it's been really fun to get out there.
Do you ever have a chuckle about maybe a casual listener who thinks the helmet sound is maybe easy, simple, I guess, in a way with,
it's hilarious. Yeah. I'm like, can you play a song? It's kind of like, trying to play an AC/DC song. Oh, I know those chords. I'm like, you sure do. Can you play 5-4 like Malcolm is doing right now in the right. breakdown of Bad Boy Boogie? No, you cannot.
Yeah.
It's the helmet thing. Do you, great bassist TM Stevens, who is the vocalist on James Brown Living in America. That's TM, who's a friend of mine from way, way, way back. We shared a rehearsal space in Hell's Kitchen in New York City. Played with, he was the last bassist in James Brown's group. He played with Miles Davis. He's on Pretenders Learning to Crawl. Phenomenal musician. And he came to see us in Asbury Park at the Stone Pony one year, many, many years ago. And he got on the bus. He's like, man, helmet's like it's like a big bowl of ice cream, it tastes really good. And then you dig in and there's spinach inside. And I go, I know. Yeah. We throw those little, that extra beat in that one measure, or the turnaround is different. The turnaround is different all three times, and it's like, I guess I get a chuckle out of it, but it's just funny people that call themselves musicians that think that our music is dumb. And I'm like, yeah, you're probably a crap musician. You know who likes my band? TM Stevens, Danny Korchmar, Tony Thundersmith, David Bowie, Elton John. These are the people that told me they like me. Neil Young came to see it, and like, those people they're pretty good. I'm like, I'll take the pat on the back from them, So it's funny.
I heard you mention in one of the interviews that you did that the Mastodon guys, and I think with some other people, they actually covered Just Another Victim, one of your most popular songs. And, when you're listening to it, you can tell what they're covering, but I think you even said that maybe they got it wrong a little bit. And if you
I hate to even, I feel bad, but they did. My drummer, texted and he's like, yeah, did you hear? And I'm like, yeah. I'm like, I don't know. Maybe they were in a hurry and they didn't get the riff right. It's, I'm flattered because I love, Bill and I had worked together. Bill and Troy and I had done some stuff in Atlanta many, many years ago, kind of a writing session. And then Braun, their drummer, came in and we never really accomplished anything because we just had so much fun together. And I love those guys and I love their band. I saw it and Bill sent it to me and I was super flattered, obviously. But yeah, I needed it. I didn't get the riff right. I'm like, all right, what are you going to do? It's just one of those things. Helmets, it's tricky, man. It's maybe it starts on the end of four. Maybe it starts on the, one E end of four, you just never know.
Yeah. And I think that's, maybe some of the reason why I love Helmet so much, love your music so much is like, there's just, you always leave like a little space there. There's always a little bit of room there, even with some of the guitars. Yeah. I think maybe that's why people think it might be easy or simple in a way, because there might be a bass break or a drum break or, just a chunky guitar and it kind of sits there for a second. But I think of I think of it in the same way that AC/DC does something like that, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. Those are my all-time heroes. I mean, I've been teaching since the pandemic. And just absolutely love it. I have mostly kind of songwriting students, but some composition, some theory, some guitar. And I use, a lot of musicians, guitarists, whatever. They're like, my rhythm feels so stiff and I'm writing and everything's just in this boring kind of time signature. And so I came up with a way to to just practice like compound rhythms, meaning like in a Helmet song, like I Care, for example, it's you can count it 1 2 1 2 3 1 2 1 2 3, so it's in five, but the drums are in four. So where does it cycle around? So I came up with this way: just set your metronome as slow as you need to set it, and mute your strings and just count 1 2 1. Excuse me, 1 2 1 2 3, 1 2 1 2 3, and your accents are going to shift. So like I mentioned, Bad Boy Boogie, the live. I think it's on If You Want Blood, right? The live version. And so there's a breakdown with Angus and Malcolm. And Malcolm is playing like all this incredible rhythm stuff. You know, it's a chord, but he's playing all these, superimposing these time signatures over the top of four in Angus is riffing. And it's just, people have no idea. You know, and I use examples from like, you know, Leonard Bernstein, song America, you know, 1 2 3, 1 2 3, da da da, you know, 1 2 3, 1 2.